And I want you to go to Isaiah chapter 55, verse number 10, and say amen when you're there. While you're going there, when I went out just now, I found this USB cable for a cell phone. Did someone drop this on the way coming in, a USB cable for a smartphone? Okay, all right, I got it right up here, all right. Last week we began talking about the doctrine of the scriptures, the truth of the scriptures, and that the Bible self-proclaims that it's true. It says that it's true, but of course the Bible itself would say that it is true. Anything that's written, even false documents, false truth, proclaims that it is the truth. That's the whole point of it. And we looked at what the Bible says about itself. It self-proclaims that it is true. And we said that in those self-proclamations, the Bible says that it is infallible. It is infallible. It is not made up of any errors, that it is inerrant. So it doesn't have any errors. No mistakes are in the Word of God. That's what it says about itself. There's no errors that have been made in it. That humans, through their copying it, the copyist, have made errors, but those errors are easily correctable because of how Scripture can never be broken and everything is tied together. But there's no errors in the Word of God. That's what we talked about last week. We talked about it being infallible, and we talked about it being inerrant there. That's what it claims. We also talked about the fact that the Bible makes claims that it is authoritative, didn't we? Meaning that it's authoritative over all things. Like it says in Isaiah, "Hear, O heavens, and hear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken." It's kind of like that commercial, when God speaks, everybody listens. It's authoritative, and it makes the claim that it is in fact the revelation, the revealed word of God, that these sayings are true. It says that about itself in Revelations 19:9, that these are the true sayings of God. It is authoritative. We learn fourthly that the word of God is complete. There's nothing to be added to it. There's nothing to be taken away. In fact, it says that there's a curse in Revelation. It says there's a curse for anyone who tries to add anything to it or take anything away from the truth of God's word. And fifthly, we learn that it was effective, which is why I had you to go to Isaiah chapter 55, verses 10 and 11. It's effective. We learn that it accomplishes it, what it sets out to do. And Isaiah 55 gives us a very powerful picture of that. I want to kind of start there where we finished last week in Isaiah 55. This is one of those scriptures that you just want to remember and highlight and keep there in your heart. Here's how it reads. "For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven and do not return there, but the water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater." It's saying that my word is the same way. Verse 11 says, "So shall my" what? "Word be that goes forward from my mouth. It shall" what? "Not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it." You know, we learned Sunday about the wheat and the tares, right? And the sower went out to sow. And we know that in sowing, as God is looking and as he's showing us here, that his word is going forward, and it is going to fall on the ground necessary that he's preordained before the foundation of the earth for it to accomplish and prosper in the thing in which he sent it to do. What he planned for our lives before the foundations of the earth, his word, as we're receiving his word, this is the sent word. Are y'all following me? It's easy to get into a wrong mystical viewing of something coming from heaven. This is what has already been sent from heaven. This is the word of God. This is what is sent right here. And when we hear it and we understand it and we obey it and we live it, it begins to accomplish. So the more that we learn it, the more that we obey it, the more that we live in the word, the more of what God has sent from heaven is accomplished in us. I love what the last part of 11 says, "And it shall prosper in the thing." I'm the thing. Amen? It's not just me that's the thing. It's all believers, all the elect, all the called are the thing. And the things need to make sure that they are getting underneath of the reign of the word as much as possible. Amen? Because it will accomplish what God has designed us to do. It will accomplish what God has planned for us to be. It will accomplish what needs to be accomplished. The reign of his word, we need to be underneath of that as much as possible. How many of us want to truly see God accomplish what he wants to accomplish in our lives? Then it's from the word. And I tell you, you're doing a great thing by coming to Bible study, by reading your Bible every single day, by coming to Sunday service, by all the things you're doing, by engaging in that. You're allowing the reign of God's word to get in the soil of the heart that he's given to you. And over time, it will accomplish exactly what he planned for it to accomplish. So tonight, we're going to pick up because we left off last week of saying, but even though the Bible says that it's true, how do we know? I mean, I didn't say anything really from an atheistic standpoint. So great, the Bible says that it's true. If we're presenting that to an atheist and we say, well, look, here's how we know the Bible's true, because it says right here that it's true. Are y'all with me? To an atheist, that's really not much different than us saying, hey, I pulled something, I printed this off of Google, and on this paper here, it says that Santa Claus is real. And it's written right here on this paper. He's real. To an atheist, that's the same thing. So the question is, how do we prove, where's the documentation? How do we prove that's what's written in it is true? You know, some would answer the question and say, well, you know, it's based on the fact that we can prove through history and archaeology and science and all these kind of things can come together to show the scriptures and show Noah's Ark and show all these things so we can look at it from that standpoint. And matter of fact, there's a good show on Discovery Channel you can go and watch. If you watch that show, you know, you'll see some truths that'll help you understand why some of these things are true. So there's all kinds of answers people could give, but I want to give you the answer biblically to that question. How do we prove that what's written in this book is true? How do we prove that the fact that it says that it's true is true? How do we prove that what's true is true? Are y'all with me? Now I have to give you a disclaimer. It's going to be easy for you in your mind to say, you know, this is not really necessary. You know, I know that it's true. I know it's the word of God. I don't know why you're teaching this lesson to me. I feel like I shouldn't have come tonight, because if you're going to sit here and try to convince me that the word of God is true, I don't need to be convinced of that, because I know that it is true. I know that it is a written word of God. Well, that's the point that we want you to see tonight is the level of how much you know and why you know, the value of why you know. Go with me in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We're looking at why, what is the evidence, what proves that the Bible is true. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 13. Say amen when you're there. Somebody's there too fast. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 13. Are you ready? These things we also speak, not in words, which what? Man's wisdom teaches, but which the who? Holy Spirit teaches, comparing what? Spiritual things with what? Spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit, for they are what? Foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he who is spiritual judges all things, and yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. You know, I want you to go back up in your text here real quick to verse number 10. I want you to see verse number 10 as well. Y'all there? Matter of fact, let's just go all the way back up to verse number 8. Let's go to verse number 7. Verse number 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery by the hidden wisdom which God ordained before when? Before the ages, before the world, before anything was even created. He ordained this. Verse 8. Which none of the rulers of this age knew. For had they known, they would have not, what? Crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eyes has not seen, nor ears heard, nor entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who what? We know what love is defined by. Love is not an emotion. It's not words, is it? Love is those who are obedient to his will. Amen? Verse 10 says, but God has revealed them. What? Reveal. What is the them? The mysteries, the wisdom. He has revealed the truth of this whole plan of his. He's revealed them to us through what? Through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of man except what? The spirit of the man which is in him. Even so, no one knows the things of God except the what? Spirit of God. And that's where it goes into what we just read. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is in God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak not in words, which is man's wisdom, but the Holy Spirit teaches. Verse 14 finishes out by saying, they are foolishness to him. So what am I saying by this? This is the answer to how do we come to believe that the word of God is true. It is by the revealing of the Holy Spirit. By the Spirit of God. It is not by archaeology. That's also just helping build the faith of someone who already believes. It's not by science. That's just building the faith of someone who already believes. It's not through personal testimony of how God has changed and impacted people's lives. That's just building the faith of those who already believed. But the way that we come to know that the word of God is true, the evidence that we have to prove that the word of God is true is given to us by the Spirit of God. Y'all got me on that. Why is this significant? Because if a person is able to, if you can literally, you got to just think about it, move slowly in your thoughts. If you can look at this word, read this word, and you can believe without doubt that it is the word and the voice of God, you did not come to that place on your own. You did not come to that place on your own intellect. You did not come to that place on your own journey of wherever road you've been traveling down. You didn't get to a certain place. It's that God chose you before the ages even began and revealed himself to you to allow you to be able to believe. That's why we don't take our walk with him for granted. Because if he's given us eyes to see and ears to hear, it is because he has a purpose and a plan for us. He is asking us to help him build his eternal kingdom. That's why he gives us ears and eyes to see. Amen? It's not just to believe. It is for the work of ministry. You know, when you think about it, we know we've been here long enough teaching. We know that there's no difference. Christians and disciples are the same. And when we see the work of the disciples, that is the work that we're doing today. When we read about the disciples and we read about the church in Acts, they should be an exact replica of what we're doing. We should be operating in such a way to where if the members of the early churches came into our church, they would feel right at home. Because we're operating, because no one made their own plan. The plan was already written. Paul said nobody else should build on any other kind of foundation. We're all building on this foundation in which Christ Jesus has already laid. And if you build it any other kind of way, the day is going to come when it's all going to be tested. Whether it's of precious stones and metals, or whether it is of straw and stubble and hay, and each one's work will be tested by the fire. There's a foundation that has been given to us that we're to build on. 1 Corinthians tells us that the Spirit of God gives certain people eyes and ears to hear. Well, what about the people who are not or appear to not be the elect? What about the people who appear to not believe, say they don't believe? God is not willing that any may perish. We are to pray for them. We can share all the, do you understand? We can share all the word we want to share. That's not going to change their inability to see God. It's not going to change that at all. What's going to change that is our prayer that God would open their ears, give them a new heart, the regeneration and recreation so that they can see that. Let me give you the best illustration I can possibly give. And all of this is so that we that can believe and can hear don't take this hearing and seeing that we have for granted. Amen? I guess the best way to look at it, humans are creatures of responding to loss. What if all of a sudden you woke up tomorrow and you couldn't figure out why you just didn't believe in God anymore? What if you woke up tomorrow and all of a sudden it didn't seem true to you anymore? It seemed like it was foolishness. What if you started having all kinds of doubts and you weren't sure and you thought there were maybe other ways what if all of a sudden all that totally was gone? Because it's designed here in this teaching tonight so that we have value for understanding that we didn't hear something and use our intellect to say, I know that that's the best deal. We heard it because we've been made sheep and we hear his voice, and that's been given to us by him first loving us. Amen? And he did that because we have a purpose. There's something he's calling us to do. Jesus said, the last words he said was to go and make disciples. Those that he's given ears to hear and eyes to see, he's given a commission to go and make disciples. Take your hearing and seeing. Take my choosing of you. Take the Holy Spirit I've given you to regenerate you and recreate you. And use your vision that's expanded beyond this world, this place, to do my work in making disciples and baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I guess the best example I could give, everyone pretty much has a smartphone or a computer of some sort right now, right? Well, if that computer is not attached to the internet, there's things that you can do, isn't it? There's information on there. There's games on there. There's some stuff that's just programmed on it as the hardware, and it has some ability and some capabilities to do some things. Isn't that right? But nothing in comparison to where when that device is connected to the internet. You almost have unlimited access to information. Isn't that correct? So let's just say you had a room full of people that had never had a smartphone before, knew nothing of the internet or anything at all, and you put them in this room. You put them in this room and you gave them a smartphone, and they learned everything on the smartphone that the smartphone had available on it. And within the environment, some people were better at learning the information that was on the smartphone than others. So those people were classified as extremely intelligent. Others maybe weren't as intelligent. But in that environment, every person there in their environment has a level of wisdom, and it's limited to what was on that smartphone. It was limited to that system and what was programmed on that phone. Isn't that right? But let's say in another room, you had a group of people and you gave them the same smartphones. But they had also access to the internet. And they were able to run freely to go beyond what's on the smartphone and start pulling information in unbelievable amounts and quantities and diversity from the World Wide Web. Is that group of people going to be much more intelligent? Are they going to have much more information? Is their perspective going to be a whole lot bigger than the people who were limited? And the difference is that some were limited just to the smart device itself. The others had the same device, but they were connected to an external source with unlimited information. Are y'all with me? I guess in my own form of a parable, the cell phone is a human. And the ones that have the smartphones that are not connected to an external source are those that are not yet regenerate, or those that have rejected the truth of God's word, those that are not the called. And those that have access to an external source are the sheep of God, the called of God. Aren't they going to see things differently? Aren't they going to know more? Aren't they going to have a whole different mindset? Aren't they going to have access to more? Is it the fault of the people in the room that they don't have the same access? It's the one that was granting the access. Does that make sense? That's how believers need to look at themselves. We don't get frustrated with those who don't believe and won't believe. We don't get frustrated with those who won't obey. They're only doing what they can do. The disobedience, the lack of repentance, the lack of belief of people around us is an indication for those of us who understand this to begin to pray that God would have mercy on their deaf ears and their blind eyes and their hard heart. Amen? That's how we know who to pray for. When we see the blind, hoping that some of the tares will turn into wheat. Y'all with me so far? See, the reason I know the Bible is true is because the Spirit of God has convinced me of it. He who has all wisdom, all power, all influence, he has convinced me of it. The one that created me gave me the ability to believe. So it's the Holy Spirit. He opens our minds to truth. You know, they've studied, you know, you've heard studies. They say that only we use about less than 10% of our mind capacity, according to scientific study. You know what? I believe the other 90% is just the potential of the saved to have perspective beyond human things, human intellect, wisdom into eternity, not just working every day to make a life here, but working every day for the eternal life, preparing for that. At the same time, spending equal, if not more, time preparing for where we're going to spend eternity, rounding up those who can hear the truth of God's word, preparing them for eternity, preparing them for the kingdom, understanding that the kingdom of God is a government, it's a rule, and it's within those who are the called. And we don't get tied up in just what's going on today. We don't even get deceived by that, as the Spirit of God truly is living in us. Because he leads and guides us into what? Truth. We don't even have to worry about who's there to comfort us and who's going to comfort us, because the same Spirit that revealed the truth of God's words to us not only leads us into truth, but he also is our what? Comforter. Amen? The Bible is primarily for those who believe it. That's who it's for. It's a book. It is 66 books. It is the scriptures, the inspired word of God, and it's only beneficial in terms of truth to those who've been given the ability to believe. The Bible essentially is for believers. The Holy Spirit's ministry, his Spirit, is to bring us into confidence, higher levels of it, higher levels of confidence, higher levels of trust in the Word of God. The Bible is for believers. Other people take it and try to, you know what's amazing is no one has disproven it. No one has disproven it. But the Bible has disproved everything else. Isn't that amazing? But again, it doesn't matter that the Bible has disproved everything else that's tried to be believed. You know, I just heard something the other day, and I'll just share it with you since y'all are sitting here. And it blew my mind. I mean, it may seem kind of foolish, but it just unlocked some unconscious perspective that I was missing. I was listening to Pastor John MacArthur, and he was talking about a whole different topic, but he related something, and it was the relating that he related it to. He said, that's just as equal to believing in Santa Claus, the Easter Bunny, or cavemen. And I understood the Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny, but the cavemen, what do you mean, the cavemen? In my mind, what I've learned, I thought the cavemen were real people. Cavemen. You all know about cavemen. Flintstones and the Neanderthal people and cavemen. I thought they existed. They fought against the dinosaurs. And that's what I believe, that they were real people, that they found them, preserved in ice blocks. Any of y'all believe that same thing that you... I believe that the cavemen, that they had found evidence of cavemen. But do you know, this isn't from a spiritual realm. In the secular world, in the worldly world, talking to real scientists and archaeologists, they say they have never found a Neanderthal man. Everything that they have thought they have found has been proven to have the same DNA makeup as people today. They've never found any evidence of any less developed people, ape-like people. Never found any human remains of any sort that don't carry the same DNA that humans today carry. Because there were no cavemen. Because the first people were people just like we are people today. The Bible tells nothing about God making another form of people or a better kind of people. He says they were sinful from the beginning and sinful to the end. And I called the sinners out of darkness into the light and gave them power to live in truth and freedom from sin. No cave people. No wondering were Adam and Eve cave people. In fact, it's just the opposite. We look at the first people as being people who may have been underdeveloped, when the truth is that they were people that were more intelligent than we are today. You say, well, they didn't have technology and they didn't, how could they be more intelligent than us? We are intelligent based on the systems that mankind has created. Just like in this room of people with smartphones not connected, there's smarter people who know more about the smartphones and because of what's been created, what's been limited, because of limited knowledge. But these people in the beginning had knowledge of God, relationship with God. They had godly wisdom, not worldly wisdom. And as people kept falling away and getting further and further away from God, they got more immersed in worldly wisdom, worldly intellect, not knowing who the true and living God was. People had more wisdom because some of them lived to be almost 1,000 years old. Amen? I don't care what time you're in, whether you're in this time or the times of the beginning, to live for 1,000 years in whatever time you're in, you have great levels of wisdom about this life. In fact, let me tell you something. Think about it yourself. Just think about it. With all the modern stuff that we have that's supposed to be so filled with intellect and intelligence, how many people can see here that the wiser you get and the older you get, the more you see that it's really nothing? Isn't that right? The more that it gets back to what's significant to really significant to us with true wisdom are the same things that were significant to people 4,000 years ago. Their walk with God. Their families, their health, same thing, same people. different time. Had to share that with you because the Word of God is what we have to stick to, because we live in a world that has unconsciously ingrained so many things in our minds that it's not so much gathering truth that's the obstacle, it is the illusion of knowledge. It's the illusion of truth that's really false truth that has to be fought through. And that's why the Bible says the Word of God is like a two-edged sword. If we allow it to, it will come in and do a surgery on our hearts, on our minds, on our thinking and everything to purge out what's false and heal us with truth. Evidence that the Bible gives shows itself, evidence to those who believe gives evidence to itself. Internally and externally, I want to give you three internal ways that the Bible gives evidence. And this is to a believer, building faith, making it more personable. Three internals, three externals. How do we know this for sure? How do we as believers? This is not a we of taking this. This isn't something we can run to somebody who's not a believer and share these three internal evidences and these three internal, it's not going to make a difference to them. No matter what they see, no matter what they hear, no matter what you expose them to, until the Lord opens their eyes and their ears, they can't see. And again, let me reiterate, that's not saying that we are to then respond with doing nothing. We're to respond with prayer. Amen? Praying. If Joey has come to visit this service, and after the service he says, you know, I don't believe really in those things, and I'm just not really sure about it. I can't convince him. I have that knowledge. I can't convince him. There's nothing I can share. All I can do is pray to God. God has given me someone now to pray for, that his eyes would be opened, that he could hear, that he'd get a new heart, that God would give him the ability to believe. I have compassion for him because there's nothing he can do on his own. It's only the God that gave me the gift of being able to see and hear that can give him the same gift. So I pray that God gives him the gift. All right? Zion's going to have to be quiet or he's going to get a spanking. We don't play that stuff. So we have mercy. We have compassion. You guys see that? We don't need to get frustrated. We don't need to get upset. It's nothing we can do. But let me tell you who we can get upset with. Those that are walking around saying they do believe. Those that are saying they're children of God. Those that are. You understand? Don't you see? That's where Jesus had his confrontations. Not with the sinners who didn't believe. They're just doing. But it's those that proclaim and say they are children of God that are acting like children of the devil. Those that say they are putting God first, but put him 15th and 20th. Those that say they are his children and they love him and he's bought them with a price, but they take their bodies and use them for whatever it is they want to do. Do you think God purchased bodies in his blood for them to be drugged through sin for the remainder of that believer's life? Do you actually believe that he gave his blood, purchased a body in his blood with the hopes that the person would take it and use it to lead a life of disobedience? He purchased it out of darkness. He purchased it so it could be free from that. We're the temples of God. And as we come to that truth, we begin to remove ourselves and repent and know that my body isn't mine to determine what I'm going to do with it. I live with this body according to stewardship because it was purchased. Can I tell you this? If you want a body that you can use to do whatever you want to do with it, you need one that's going to hell. If you want a body that you can use to put in whatever you want to put into it and to use it for whatever you want to get into, if you want a body that you can have control over, you need a body that's going to hell. But if you want to go to heaven, you need a purchased body from the blood of Jesus Christ that has been pulled out of sin into the holiness of God. Amen? That wasn't part of the Bible study tonight. But it's good. Thank you, Brother Tony. So here are these evidences. Here are the internal evidences. Number one, we can see these internal evidences of the truth of God's word, not just through the fact that the Bible says it is true, but through the testimony of the writers. We see the testimony of the writers. The writers themselves, we see the Hall of Fame of Faith. We see that in the writers, they claim to be speaking the word of God, the testimony of the writers, the Old Testament writers, the New Testament writers, they all are speaking and proclaiming the word of God. Go with me to Acts chapter 1, verse 16. Acts chapter 1, that's in your New Testament. Chapter 1, verse number 16. And say amen when you are there. The testimony of these writers that are writing in the Bible, all these people of God who are writing based on what God has superintended. They're not just coming up with ideas or thoughts or whatever have you. It's not based on their own wisdom. These writers were everyday, ordinary people. They made direct claims to being inspired by God. They were making claims to the fact that it was not them. In fact, there are 3,800 references to where they are identifying themselves in the Bible, and just in the Old Testament alone, 3,800 in the Old Testament alone, where the writers are identifying themselves as speaking on behalf of God. Over 1,000 references to the Old Testament quotes in the New Testament as them acknowledging that they are speaking from the Word of God and the truth of God and that they believe what the Old Testament writers wrote. And in Acts chapter 1, verse number 16, it says, men, I'll read verse 15 as well. It says, and in those days, Peter, one of the apostles, stood up in the midst of the disciples. Altogether, the number and names was about 120, and said, men and brethren, this what? Now, in your Bible, some of your Bibles, raise your hand if the word scripture in your Bible has a capital S. Now, for those of you who've been to any type of English grammar school training or whatever have you, you don't capitalize an S in the middle of a sentence with the lacking of a period or some type of punctuation. Nate, is that right? I didn't do good in English at all, but I know that. So listen, so in reference to this scripture here, you see this. So what is this? What is this scripture? This is the identification, because the Bible you have is written in Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic. And if you look at the Greek meaning of that, this is talking about the inspiration, the inspired word of God, the scriptures being God himself. The word became flesh. If we were to go over to 1 John 1:14, when it says, and the word was with God, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us, we would see capital W's on the word in the middle of a sentence, meaning that that was God himself in the flesh. The scriptures here, this is God himself inspiring. This is him. They said, men and brethren, this scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit, what? Spoke. By the who? By the mouth of David. They were saying here, listen, this is what they're showing, is that they literally believed and they understood that the Old Testament prophets, that they spoke the word of God, that what David said came out of his mouth, but came directly from God. Are y'all with me on that? The testimony of the writers themselves testifying that what they spoke was spoken on God's behalf, and that those that came after them believed that what they spoke was spoken on God's behalf. Look at Galatians chapter 1, verse 15. Go over to Galatians chapter 1. Just go past Corinthians. Get over to Galatians chapter 1. As a matter of fact, we'll look at verse 11 first. Galatians chapter 1, and we'll go to verse 11. Galatians 1, 11, I think is what I got here. Say amen when you're there. Okay, all right. So, looking at the testimony of the writers, I'll read from 11 to 15. It says, but I make known to you, brethren, whenever you see the word brethren in the New Testament, almost all the time, it is meaning brethren, like in church, those that are saved, saints, saints, brethren, all the same. But I make known to you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not what? According to man. In other words, what I'm preaching is not something that any man came up with. For I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but it came through what? The revelation of Christ. Jesus reveals the truth, the gospel. That has to be revealed to a person. How does a person know the gospel? How does a person know the good news? How does a person know that? They can't know it or believe it or receive it or live it unless it is revealed to them by Christ. Amen? It's revealed. We're always trying to share the word sometimes, aren't we? But we need to have a greater focus on praying that God would open eyes, hearts, and minds so that it can be revealed to them. Y'all got that so far? Testimony of the writers. Let's see what time we have. Here's the second one I'll give you. And I'll just share this with you. We won't go to all these scriptures, but I want to share with you of how these writers in the New Testament begin to corroborate one another. Go with me to this one, 1 Timothy 5:18. Go with me to this one here. I want you to see this. 1 Timothy 5:18. Say amen when you're there. 1 Timothy 5:18. It says in 1 Timothy 5:18, for the scripture says, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain, and the laborer is worthy of his wages. You say, well, what in the world does that have to do with anything that we're talking about? These New Testament writers begin to corroborate one another in the fact that they believe that one another is actually sharing the truth of God's word through the scriptures. They've been inspired with the truth of God's word. Because the first part of this, let me show you an example. This is an example of the testimony of the writers. The first part of this scripture, you shall not muzzle an ox, comes from Deuteronomy 25, verse 4. So here in the New Testament is being quoted by Paul. Paul is here now quoting what actually was written by an Old Testament writer, showing how he believed that what the Old Testament writers wrote were inspired by God, or otherwise they wouldn't have spoken anything that they didn't believe was inspired by God. Are you with me? It's the corroboration showing that the testimony of the writers is showing how they all believed that one another had been inspired to write the word and the truth of God's word. So that's the first part of that. And then in Galatians 5:18, the second part of that says the laborer is worthy of his wages. That comes from Luke 10:17. So in one scripture, Paul has corroborated his belief in what's written in Deuteronomy according to the law being inspired in the word of God, and what one of the apostles has written about the word of God. It's not the content of it that we're reading tonight. I want you to see that they're corroborating. They're quoting from one another, signifying their belief that the word of God is inspired. Amen. Raise your hand if you see that. You understand that? The power of it, and all of them coming together. Number two, here's the number two, internal evidence. We see the testimony of the writers, but here's the testimony of Jesus Christ. The testimony of Jesus Christ. Go with me to John 10. Go to John 5 first, since we're going in that direction after. John 5. The testimony of Jesus Christ is what builds the faith and confidence of believers. The evidence to those who believe, more evidence. John 5 and verse number 39. Say amen when you're there. John chapter 5, verse 39. And I'm sorry. I mean to be telling you John 10, 35. John 10, 35. Oh, no, you're right. I'm sorry. Stay right there. I'm looking in the wrong book. John 5:39, it says, you search the what? Scriptures. The scriptures, you see scriptures again? That's the word of God, the inspired word of God. Meaning this isn't just any written, something that's just written. This is inspired. The scriptures, this is no joke. That's what we're reading. Everything we read here, these scriptures, that's why they're so valuable. That's why we read them every day. That's why we let nothing get before that. Because there's the scriptures, they're that valuable. That's how we view them. You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. And these are they who testify of me, but you are not willing to come to me that you may have life. Did y'all get that? He says, you search the scriptures. You are searching the scriptures because in them you think eternal life is tied to the scriptures, but you're not willing to come to me. What does that mean? You're not willing to repent and turn away from your life and press forward to the call of God. The scriptures, look at John 10:35, the testimony of Jesus Christ. This is Jesus speaking. This is what he believes about the scriptures, how he shows his value and belief about the scriptures. John 10:35. Y'all ready? It says, if he called them gods, this is little gods, to whom the word of God came, and the scripture cannot be what? Broken, meaning the scripture is absolute, it is definite. The scriptures cannot be broken. The truth of God's word cannot be broken. That's the testimony of Jesus Christ. Look at Matthew. Go to the book of Matthew. Chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, verse number 17. Say amen when you're there. Matthew 5:17. He says, do not think that I came to destroy the law of the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to do what? To fulfill it. He came to fulfill the scriptures, came to fulfill what was written in the law, came to fulfill it. Matthew 26. Keep going over. Go to Matthew 26. Matthew 26, verse number 54. Look at what the Word of God says as we look at Jesus' testimony in regards to the Scriptures. Matthew 26, 54. Y'all there? It says, how then could the Scriptures be what? That this must happen. And it's about the scriptures. He's saying, listen, this is my view of them, that everything that's been written in them, what's been written in the scriptures, that it must be fulfilled. Everything written has to be fulfilled. He knew every scripture had to be filled. He knew that every scripture was inspired by the word of God. Let's go to Luke chapter 16, verse 17. Luke 16:17. Say amen when you're there. Here's Jesus speaking. He says in Luke 16:17, and it is easier for what? Heaven and earth to pass away than for one tittle of the law to fail. It's easier for heaven and earth as we know it today to pass away than for the jot and tittle are the smallest letters of the Greek alphabet. It's like the period or something in the English vocabulary. That it'd be easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one little punctuation mark in the scriptures to pass away, to ever fail, to not happen. Y'all got that? So Jesus, he did many miracles, many amazing things with the scriptures and the truth of them as he began to expound on them. And when we're dealing with people on this truth about the inspired word of God, here are the three people, here are the three categories of people that we're going to encounter when it comes to the truth and the authenticity of God's word. Some are going to say, one category is that there are errors. There are errors in the Bible. There are mistakes in the Bible. It's been tampered with. And some are going to say in that same statement that Jesus didn't know about them. He didn't know about them. They didn't know about them. They don't know about it today. They're errors and nobody knows about them. The Christians don't know about them. The believers are ignorant to the fact that these scriptures have been tampered with. That they're not accurate. That it's not the true word of God. The question I would have if I had any more energy or knew it was in a level of not being disobedient to pursue it any further would be, well, what evidence do you have of whatever you believe being the word of God? Because they don't believe anything. They don't know what to believe. They're lost. They can't believe. It's impossible for them to believe. There's nothing I can show them to make them believe. There's nothing they can see that make them believe. If 75-pound hailstones came out of the sky, they won't believe. There's nothing that can be done. The only thing I can do, the only hope, can y'all see that? The only hope is that when we pray for them, amen, that God's will would be done, whatever that is, that he would open ears and eyes. So you got people who say this, listen, it's not the word of God because it's inaccurate, it's untrue in that way, it's been tampered with. Some people say, but Jesus, you know, they covered them up. They covered up the errors and things like that, that in the time when the word of God, they have covered these things up and Jesus was a part of covering it up. And then the believers, they basically understand and know that there are no errors because of what they've seen it do in their own personal lives, because of the effectiveness of it. A believer believes the truth of God's word because if they have seen the effect of it, the power of it, the delivering power of it, the freeing power of it. They've seen it. That's why a believer believes, because they've been given the ability to believe by God. And then as they receive the word, learn the word, obey the word, live the word, they've seen how it affects and transforms their life. So they know. And it's not just based on what's written. It's not based on anything that's happened. It's not based on anybody else's testimonial. It's based on the effect and the impact. Let me give you just a couple more and we'll close out. The testimony of the writers, the testimony of Jesus Christ himself, the testimony of the Holy Spirit. This one is very significant. The testimony of the Holy Spirit. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2 again. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we're going to be looking at verses 7 through 13 to close out. The others are still, in a sense, objective. They're objective. The testimony of the writers, objective. The testimony of Jesus, still objective. It's in the text. It's written in the text, meaning objective. It's right there written in the text. You can see it. You can see what Jesus said about the scriptures. You can see what the writers said about the scriptures. But this last one that we'll give you in terms of internal evidence, this is the testimony of the Holy Spirit. This is subjective. Subjective, meaning that it is experienced. It is given. It is something that is done outside of the text, proven by what we experience and what we live as the believer. You're already 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom for which God ordained before the ages. So that's how we speak. We speak with wisdom, the believer, from being revealed by the Holy Spirit in terms of God's truth. We're speaking of wisdom that comes from before the earth was created. You got to catch that point. Because when you're trying to dialogue with somebody who only has wisdom based on after this world was created, after the fall, after man's sin, after man's creation of all that man has created, man's corruptness, the system of the world that Satan has put in place that he's the father over, when you're trying to dialogue with somebody that has wisdom based on that, The wisdom you're given that's before the foundations of the earth and extends beyond the earth as we know it today is going to sound like foolishness to them who don't believe. Y'all got that? And we pray that God would open eyes and open ears. It says that we speak in this wisdom, the hidden wisdom, for before the ages, before the ages, for our glory, which none of the rulers of this age knew, for they had known, they would have not crucified him. And I love verse number 9. But as is written, this is quoting from the Old Testament: eyes has not seen, nor ears heard, nor has entered into the heart of men. That's the Holy Spirit. You understand that, right? The things which God has prepared for those who love him. But that was from the Old Testament. It hadn't happened at that point in time. They hadn't seen it. They didn't understand the full picture of God, the mysteries of God. They didn't understand it at that point in time. That's why Jesus said everything has to be fulfilled, all of what was happening in the future. Verse 10 says, but God has revealed them to us. Who's the us? Those of us who have ears to hear, eyes to see, a heart to love, a desire to obey, willingness to repent. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. You can confidently tell someone, you cannot believe what I believe unless the Spirit of God reveal it to you. You can't see what I see unless God opens your eyes. Some, you see the difference? They can't see what you see, but you can see what they see. Amen? Because they may want to try to tell you, well, you know what, you can't see. They don't even have anything to tell you, just to let you know. I'm kind of giving them more credit than what they have. They don't even have anything to tell you about their God. Because the thing that we have is not just what's written, not just the testimony of the writers, not just the testimony of Jesus Christ, not just that, but we have the testimony of the Holy Spirit that we know lives in us, that is transforming and sanctifying our lives every single day. We see it happening. Even when we are astray, even when we are walking, we literally see God drawing us, calling us, shaping us, convicting us. We see the power of what's happening. And it's only the Spirit of God that has revealed that to us. You can't say that because I had an experience or because I'm a better person, that that's the truth of God's word. You can be in a lot of religions, false religions, and you can become a better person because you're around people with better standards. You can just be better. You can be more focused. They can have an impact. Organizations and groups and things can have an impact on people's life. So you can't look at that and just say, well, because I had that kind of experience. But let me tell you the experience of a believer that is converted. They have had an experience to where they see beyond this life, and they see before this world was created, and they have a fire inside of them to be a part of building the future kingdom that is coming. That's what Christianity is all about. Not that I'm a better person here on this earth. Yes, that's going to happen. Not that I had an experience or an encounter of some sort that did something. That's it. No, but that I now see the kingdom of God. If a man is not born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God that is being built, that is being prepared, that is coming, that is going to replace this world as we know it today, that those that are the called of God will spend eternity with Jesus Christ. That's what they see. And they're not trying to apply it to anything they're doing in their careers or their businesses or their households or anything at all. It's the kingdom of God that is totally coming to do away with all the material things and the physical things and the tangible things that are here. The kingdom of God. The church that's being built. That the gates of hell cannot prevail against. Being born again, the Spirit reveals to us the kingdom. You ever heard somebody say, yeah, I think the Holy Spirit talked to me and told me something, whatever have you? I'm telling you, the next words that ought to come out of their mouth is, I have seen the kingdom coming. That's what the Holy Spirit, that's what his ministry is. That's what he's doing all day long, 24 hours a day, is revealing the kingdom of God that is coming and the help, the laborers that he is calling to be a part of building it. See, the kingdom is coming. The kingdom is within those that are truly saved, and the believers are a part of rounding up the people that are going to inherit the kingdom. When someone has heard from the Holy Spirit, that's what they've heard. That's the message. That's what they will have heard. If I'm seeing the kingdom, I'm seeing the work that's to be done. I'm seeing the ministry that needs to be done. I'm seeing why I need to be who I need to be. I'm seeing why I need to read my word. I'm seeing why I need to study. I'm seeing why I need to go to church. I'm seeing why I need to be in Bible study. I'm seeing why I need to repent of sin. I'm seeing this. I'm seeing. When the Holy Spirit is talking to someone, he comes to convict the world of sin. He comes to lead us in the truth. He comes to give us comfort as we're struggling and falling. And he comes to show us and reveal to us the kingdom of God. And he extends a call to prepare for the coming king. Amen. Let's stand to our feet and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for this time that you've given us, for this word that you've given us tonight. Thank you that you've given us the blessing of being able to hear and see. Thank you for giving us new hearts. Thank you for the regeneration that is taking place and the regeneration that may be taking place, Lord. Let us be who you want us to be. We come asking now, Lord, for fresh commitment, fresh renewal, fresh desire, fresh priority. You are first. And Lord, we ask that you have mercy on us, Lord, and allow us to continually be able to see more and more of the kingdom, to continually be able to see more and more of what you call us to do, to continually be able to more and more repent of things we don't even know we need to repent of at this time, Lord, to continually, Lord, be able to hear your call and obey your call to build your kingdom, to build your church, to do your will, to be your ambassador, your representative, to be the light, to be the salt, to be representation of the next race of people. We thank you for the blessings you give us through the truth of your word, the inspired scriptures that you've given us, the breath you've given us, the life you've given us through the truth of your word. We don't take it for granted. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a great night. We look forward to seeing you on Sunday.